on CPAP. So let us look at the indications and how do we initiate CPAP. Once you start CPAP, how do you monitor and how do you maintain the baby on CPAP? When do you start weaning and when do you say the baby needs to be shifted to a higher support, and when do we remove the baby from CPAP and how do we remove that baby? So before we start CPAP, these are the minimum requirements in all the facilities. I assume that you have enough adequate number of nurses and doctors to monitor these babies, but the apart from the doctors and nurses, trained doctors and nurses, these are your minimum requirements. You need a compressed centralized air source. So that means either you need an air cylinder or you need a compressed air source, which is a central air source. Then you need a central oxygen or a oxygen cylinder. Then to mix these two, air and oxygen, you need a blender or a Y connection, because you want to see how much air and how much oxygen should be mixed to get the appropriate FiO2 to be delivered to the baby. So you need a good blender or at least a Y connection. If you don't have a blender, you need a Y connection. Then the most important part I keep stressing of a CPAP is having a appropriate humidifier. It should be a servo humidifier which deliver gases at the nose at 37 degrees Celsius with 100% relative humidity. This is the crux of management of CPAP, the servo humidifier. Then you need disposable circuits and you also need correct interface to fix onto the baby. We have innovated a lot on these interfaces and I would like to give you some very simple advice. What is the best interface? How can you get the least nasal injury? And I will try to simplify how we can manage a baby on CPAP. So this is what you, this is the best thing to have, a bubble CPAP where you have a humidifier, you have a blender, you have air and oxygen and a flow meter, and you have a bubble chamber. If you don't have this, you can have another bubble chamber, or this is called a flow driver CPAP. It is marketed in India. You have another CPAP which is marketed by Hamilton, which again is very simple. It is a bubble CPAP. And you have a Vapotherm. Vapotherm was the gold standard CPAP, which is used in the Western world, mostly European countries. But in India, because of the cost efficaciousness, bubble CPAP is the most favored one. Vapotherm, the only difference of Vapotherm is this humidifier. The humidifier in Vapotherm is slightly different from the humidifier which you normally see in bubble CPAP. You can also do CPAP with ventilation. And we prefer to do ventilation CPAP only when the baby is shifted from ventilation to CPAP, so that you don't have to change the circuits. With the same circuits of ventilation, you can do CPAP and you can decrease the non-invasive ventilation, invasive ventilation duration. So basically, the crux of CPAP is having the correct humidifier. These are the different types of humidifiers which are available in the market. The cost range of all of them is the same, somewhere between 80 to 90,000 rupees. But whenever you buy a humidifier, you have to ensure that the display temperature should be 37. That means the gas going to the baby goes at 37 degrees Celsius. And it should have a heating element in the inspiratory limb. So you should have in the circuit, in the inspiratory circuit, there should be a heating wire. And this wire continues to heat the gases from humidifier till it goes to the patient. So this is the crux of humidifier, having a servo humidifier which delivers the gases to the nose at 37 degrees with 100% relative humidity. So humidifier is the most important part. Then comes the next part is the air-oxygen blender. Air, oxygen and blender. Air gives 21% oxygen. Oxygen gives 100% oxygen. To give how much of the fraction oxygen we have to give to the baby, we have to have a blender. Because this blender mixes the air and oxygen in such a way that the gas coming out of the blender as appropriate FiO2. Suppose you set FiO2 50%, then it will mix the air and oxygen in such a way that the air coming out from the blender has 50%. And how much flow should come to the circuit? This is the flow meter. So flow meter determines how much flow should be there in the circuit. FiO2 determines what type of gas should be there in the circuit. The quality of gas is decided by the blender. The quantity of gas in the circuit is decided by the flow meter. So normally when we start CPAP, we start with the FiO2 of 30% and a flow of 5 liters. 5 liters flow, FiO2 30% is what we should aim for to starting. This is another CPAP machine which is very similar, but all these are inbuilt in the in the machine here. You can see everything out here, but it is inbuilt inside this. So air, oxygen, blender, flow meter, then you need a pressure generator. Humidifier, air, oxygen, blender, flow meter, and next is a pressure generator. So this is the pressure generator in bubble CPAP. In bubble CPAP, you are putting the expiratory limb. This is the expiratory limb which is going inside water. And how much is the depth of immersion from the water level? How much this tube is inside? Suppose from the water level, the tube is 5 cm inside. The pressure in the circuit is 5 cm. From the water level, if the tube is 6 cm inside, then the pressure is 6 cm inside the circuit, and that is the pressure which goes to the patient. So to increase the pressure going to the patient, you push this tube inside so that from the water level, the tube is 6 cm inside. You want to decrease the pressure, you pull this tube outside, so that from the water level, the tube immersion depth decreases. So whatever is displayed here, if it is 4 cm here, means from the water level, the tube is 4 cm inside. When you push it, if it becomes 5, from the water level, it is 5 cm. So this is what is generating the pressure in bubble CPAP. So you have the pressure, which is 5 cm. You have the flow, which is 5 liters. And FiO2, we used to say 50%. But we are saying it is 30%. You start with 30% FiO2, flow of 5 liters and FiO2, 30% flow of 5 liters and the third component is the pressure of 5 centimeters. Now, this is another method of creating pressure. This is called a flow driver CPAP. Here, there is no expiratory limb. There is only one limb, that is the inspiratory limb, and there is a pressure manometer. So, whatever gas is going, it is going to the baby directly. Depending upon how much is the flow in the circuit, the pressure is built in the nasal interface. So this is the flow driver CPAP. The pressure in a flow driver CPAP is inside the nasal interface. In a bubble CPAP, the pressure is built in the bubble chamber. So I hope all of you understood. To deliver CPAP, you need a compressed air source, compressed oxygen source, a blender, a flow meter, a humidifier, and a pressure generator. Could be a bubble or could be a interface like a flow driver. Now, what are the other requirements? So to do justice to doing CPAP correctly, all of you should know very simple score called Silverman-Anderson score. I hope all of you know this. I hope that most of you must have already been educated. If you don't know, please look at this score. This is the simplest score because this will tell you how the alveoli are. The more the score, the alveoli are more collapsed. So you need to give more pressure. If the alveoli are open, the Silverman score is low. That means your pressure requirement is less. So normally we say for a preterm baby with a Silverman score more than 3, he is at the requirement for CPAP. In a term baby, if the Silverman score is more than 5, he has a requirement for CPAP. Less than 3 in preterm, less than 5 in term babies, you can still do with nasal oxygen or sometimes with high flow nasal cannula. Silverman score more than 3 in preterm, CPAP. More than 5 in term babies, CPAP. Silverman score is a guide for your alveolar collapse. Higher the score, more is the retraction, more is the need for CPAP or pressure. So what all components it has? It has nasal flaring, it has grunt, it has got retraction, upper chest retractions, lower chest retractions, and sternal retractions. What is this upper chest, lower chest? Upper chest is from the mid axillary line, whatever is above is the upper chest. Below the mid axillary line is lower chest. So when the baby is sleeping like that, if this is the mid axillary line, whatever retractions are there below the mid axillary line, it is lower chest. Whatever is above the mid axillary line, it is upper chest. So based on the upper chest, lower chest, sternal, nasal flaring and grunting, you decide the score. I will show you the score in the chart in the end, but all of you should, your nurses should be well versed with the Silverman-Anderson score. Then you need a pulse oximeter because we are telling how much of oxygen we have to give to the patient. How much pressure we have to go give to the patient is based on your saturations. If saturations are low, you have to give either oxygen or pressure. If your saturations are low, you can give either oxygen or pressure. So when do we give oxygen? When do we give pressure? So suppose you have low saturation and baby has retractions, then you give pressure. So increase the pressure. Suppose you have low oxygen, retractions are not there much, then you increase oxygen. So hypoxia with retractions, you increase pressures. Hypoxia alone, not much retractions, you increase FiO2. So what you do with pulse oximeter is look at the saturation. What saturation you want? 90 to 95%. Not above 95, not below 90. So it is also a good thing to have multi-channel monitor because you need to monitor the blood pressures. If your baby has hyperinflation, that means no retraction, but the chest is hyperinflated, venous returns will come down. If venous return comes down, blood pressure may fall, come down. So if your blood pressure comes down, you can pick up with a multi-panel monitor. If the blood pressure is coming down, that means it could be that your pressure is high or you are into a case of hypovolemia. You also need a portable X-ray. You cannot move a baby on CPAP to the X-ray room. The portable X-ray should come onto the baby because your lung volume and your diagnosis is made from the X-ray. Low lung volume, you have to increase the pressure. Normal lung volume, your pressure is okay. High lung volume, you have to decrease the pressure. So what is low, what is normal, and what is high lung volume? Low is when your intercostal spaces are less than 6 spaces. Normal is when your intercostal spaces are 6 to 8 spaces. High volume is when your intercostal spaces are more than 8 spaces. More than 8 spaces, you have to decrease the pressure. 6 to 8 spaces, your pressures could be normal. That means there is no need to change your CPAP pressure. If your volume is low, that means your intercostal spaces are less than 6, then you have to increase your CPAP pressure. So the two methods of changing pressure is, one is saturation, second is X-ray. Low saturation, retractions, increase the pressure. Low saturation, no retractions, increase the FiO2. Now low saturation, lung is showing low volume, increase the pressure. Low saturation, lung is showing normal volume or increased volume, increase the FiO2. So these two criteria, retractions and X-ray, will tell you whether you can increase the pressure or increase the FiO2. So that is why portable X-ray is very important. Then you also need to give surfactant because your CPAP will help maybe 50 to 60% of babies. Another 30-40% of babies, you can avoid ventilation by using surfactant. So in our own study, when you give surfactant early, your CPAP, your ventilation requirement is only 15% in preterm babies, 28 to 34 weeks. But if you delay giving surfactant, your ventilation requirement is 30%. So to decrease ventilation requirement from 30 to 15%, you have to give early surfactant. So when do you give surfactant? If a baby is on CPAP and if your FiO2 requirement is more than 30%, then that is a candidate for giving surfactant. And how do you give surfactant? Intubate, give surfactant, extubate, and put him back onto CPAP. That is called Ensure technique. It is also desirable but not a must to have a blood gas and a backup ventilator. So if you don't have this, you can still do CPAP, but ensure that if the baby is not succeeding, then you should know where to refer this baby. Now, when do we start CPAP? So we start CPAP, the prime requirement is baby should have spontaneous breathing. Baby could have respiratory distress, but he should be breathing. Babies who have severe asphyxia, babies who have multi-organ failure, baby have severe shock, those babies are not candidate for CPAP. Babies who are candidate for CPAP are pure RDS cases, pneumonia, meconium aspiration, where distress is severe, but respiratory efforts are good. So whenever you want to give CPAP, respiratory efforts should, because CPAP does nothing to wash out the CO2. It will only help in improving oxygenation. So in a preterm baby, if a baby has respiratory distress and a Silverman score more than 3, you have to start him on CPAP. Irrespective of whether his saturation is normal or not, whatever be the saturation, if you have a preterm baby, Silverman score more than 3, the baby is candidate for CPAP. Now, who is a preterm baby? For CPAP, a preterm baby is baby till 34 weeks, not 37 weeks. Preterm baby for CPAP is 34 weeks. 35, 36, 37 and time baby, you will start CPAP if the Silverman NS score is more than 5. Babies with recurrent apneas also, you can start CPAP. And extubation, post-extubation, ventilated, and you want to remove the ventilator early, you will put the baby on CPAP. CPAP is also useful sometimes to treat tracheomalacia and phenicnopalsy because it splints the diaphragm and prevents alveolar collapse. In a term near newborn, pneumonia, meconium aspiration, sometimes severe tetany, also you can give CPAP, but they should have distress, which where Silverman Anderson score is more than 5. Now, what are the contraindications? As I already told, babies with severe asphyxia, babies with shock, multi-organ dysfunction, CPAP should not be given. You should go for ventilation. Those with diaphragmatic hernia, those with tracheoesophageal fistula, those with cardiovascular instability, those with coronary arteries and cleft palate are the contraindications. Now, gradually, these contraindications also are coming down. Now, you can see in the next slide, this is the baby with cleft palate who was given CPAP with your resuscitation mask. You can see the resuscitation mask covering the nose, mouth. There is a feeding tube which is coming out, and this is fixed with to the CPAP. Inspiratory limb, expiratory limb, the Y connection, mask, and mask is fixed onto the cap. So you are able to do CPAP even cleft palate babies. So previously cleft palate used to be a contraindication because you put the prongs in the nose, there will be leak through the mouth. So but here you are covering the nose and the mouth. So you can do CPAP even babies with the cleft palate. So how do we start? Now first thing is baby comes to you. NICU baby lands up. Baby has respiratory distress. So he has a Silverman score more than 3. Preterm baby, 30 weaker, 1.2. As soon as you come, put him on pulse oximeter. And set up your machine. Give oxygen and pulse oximeter till your machine is started. Fix the cap. Fix the prongs. Connect the prong to the circuit and to the machine. Which prongs you can use? Your many varieties. Fisher and Paykel, Hudson, Inca, Rams cannula. I am going to show how to fix the Rams cannula and the Hudson prongs. So the others, Fisher and Paykel, Inca, you can continue to use it. If you are already using it, you should continue to use it because as you keep using, then your experience increases, your nasal injury will come down. So I will show you the videos of creating the CPAP as well as fixing of the interface. Can you see the video in the chat? Yes, you can tell me. Okay, yeah. Okay. This video is available on the YouTube. So wash your hands.
There is no sound in the video, right?
Yeah, there is sound in the video. You can't hear?
No.
You can't hear the sound?
No, we can't actually.
Okay. So how do we make sure? So anyway, so I will tell them. So now you clean the circuit, clean the machine with a sterilium. You're cleaning the temperature probes, connect oxygen, connect air. So again, because you have cleaned the machine, go and wash your hands. Wear some disposable gloves. Open the circuit. Take the humidifier chamber. Fix it to the humidifier. Fill distilled water. Now distilled water is available in the distilled water bottle. So it is preferable to use the distilled water. So fill it to the level. Now this is the bubble chamber. So pour water in the double chamber. This can be distilled water or this can be potable water, drinking water also. And fix it. So now you are to the humidifier chamber, you are connecting the inspirator limb. So this is a pressure release valve. This is a pressure release valve. This has 3 ports. This is a pressure release valve. This pops off when the pressure goes more than 17 centimeters. This knob here is to see how much pressure is going into the circuit. So you can add a manometer here and see. And this is what is for measuring how much FiO2 is going to the circuit. So you can fix a FiO2 monitor here and see the FiO2 going into the circuit. And here you are connecting the gas from the blender to the bubble chamber to the humidifier. So this green wire is connecting, green tube is connecting gas from the blender from the flow meter to the humidifier chamber. So from there, humidifier chamber, this is the inspirator limb, the blue wire. Now from the inspirator limb, you seal using the expirator limb, which is white, and seal the expirator limb to the bubble chamber. Now when you seal it, you should be able to see the bubbles. So bubbles are there means now no bubbles were there because there was some leak. Now you are connecting the temperature probes, heater wires. Yes. So connect the heater wire and the temperature probe. Now switch on the humidifier. It should read 37 before you connect it to the patient. Now you see the bubbles have started. Set the flow rate at 5 liters. FiO2, it is shown 50% here, but 30% and pressure of 5. So temperature should be 37. Pressure should be 5. FiO2 30%, flow of 5 liters. FiO2 30%, pressure 5, flow 5 liters. Look for bubbles. Now we have closed the inspirator and expirator limb together. And this temperature should come to 37 before we connect to the patient. So that is what you have now set the machine. Now let us look how to set the prongs. So here we are showing you how to set the Hudson prongs. Now Hudson prongs is easiest. So wash your hands. You need all this. You need a gown, you need a Hudson prongs, you need a Tegaderm, you need safe care gloves, you need a scissor and some connectors, safety pins, rubber bands to fix the Hudson prongs. So now open the Hudson prongs. These are how they look like. You have a cap and you have the Tegaderm. Now Hudson prongs come in different sizes. There is a size specificity for less than 700 grams, 700 to 1000, 1000 to 500 grams, 1000 to 1500 grams, 1000, 1500 to 2000. So you should know which prong to pick up for which baby. So we'll show you that. Now cut the Tegaderm. This is called Velcro, which comes in the circuit. There is a rough circuit, a rough Velcro and a small soft Velcro. So you cut the rough Velcro and the soft Velcro. See the way it is cut. This is the rough Velcro. Bend it and make a V connection there. So this is the rough Velcro. So we have cut two soft Velcros, one rough Velcro and the Tegaderm. Now we are fixing the interfaces. This is Hudson prong. You have two connectors. To the Hudson prongs, you are fixing these soft Velcros, which you have already cut on both sides. So the soft Velcros are cut and connected. See, the tails have to be away from the prongs. The tails have to be away from the prongs. The connectors, you cap it with a IV port. And these connectors are already there with the circuit. So inspiratory and expiratory connectors connected to the prongs. Now you are ready to fix onto the baby. Now use a cap. When you use the cap to cover, ensure that the ears are covered. The cap should snugly fit. And while you are fitting, that oxygen should be flowing to the patient. So fix the Tegaderm on the upper lip. Fix the rough Velcro. The V is facing towards the nose. Then the interface, Hudson prong, these soft Velcros are going to connect to the rough Velcro which you have fixed on the upper lip. And this prong should snugly fit into the nose. This snug prong should snugly fit into the nose and there should not be any free space. They should be snugly fit, but there should not be over distension of the nose. There should not be blanching. When you fix it, ensure that there is no blanching. Complete fixation without blanching. The nose, your prongs are appropriately fixing for the baby. Now you fix the inspiratory limb to one end. To one end. And expiratory limb to the other side. So the blue is connected to one side. The white is connected to the other side. Now we have to fix these interface to the cap. And for that you use the use the safety pins. So first fix the interface and then fix the interface to the cap so that they stay at one place. Make a Y of the rubber band and then fix the interface to the cap. Okay, do this on the same side. Now your bubble CPAP is connected to the patient. This is a patient interface connected. Now you should put an orogastric tube. After putting the interface, immediately you have to put an orogastric tube because you want to vent out the air which goes into the tummy and avoid bubbles CPAP belly. And this should be fixed onto the side. The tip should be above the level of the tummy. So now the baby is comfortable. Now you can see the complete circuit, inspirator limb, expirator limb. Now I am showing again the complete circuit, air, oxygen, blender, flow meter, gas is flowing to the humidifier, the pressure release valve, flow FiO2 monitoring, humidification, gas is getting heated in the inspirator limb, continues to get heated in the inspirator limb, and then this gas goes to the patient, and from the patient, so you see that is gas is going to the patient, and from the patient, the gas expirator limb is going to the bubble chamber. Ensure that these inspirator expirator limbs are supported with a small towel. And this is going into the patient. You should see the bubbling. If bubbling is there, that means the interface are fixed well. There are no leaks in the circuit. So that is what is the Hudson prongs. I want to show you one more thing, that is your Rams cannula. Can you people see this Rams cannula?
Right now we can see a green screen.
Yeah, so I will ensure the Rams. Just 1 second. Sure. Now we can see?
Yes, sir.
So this is a fixation of the Rams cannula. You have various sizes Rams cannulas. You can choose any one Ram cannula. So Rams cannula, it comes in multiple sizes. Choose one of them. It is almost like your nasal prongs. So now to prevent damage with the Rams cannula, you have to use a tegaderm again. So the tegaderm is fixed onto the nose. There is something called duoderm. Duoderm is fixed onto the nose. I will show you another picture how you can fix a duoderm. And the Rams cannula is fitted onto the baby. You can use the Rams cannula to deliver CPAP to babies who are weighing more than 1 kg. So less than 1 kg preferable to use. So Rams cannula is fitted to the Y connection inspiratory expiratory limb and it is fixed to the baby. So you can see it is connected to the bubble CPAP machine. You can connect it to the ventilator and do even a nasal IMV also you can do with the Rams cannula. So am I clear on the fixation of the interface as well as on the machine fixation? Any problems here so far? Sir, that, no Gupta sir, can you see? Could you see all the videos?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now we will move on. So now we have started the baby on CPAP. We fixed everything. Now let us go and see how we have to deliver the CPAP more better to the baby. Now we have seen the videos. This is how a complete circuit of a bubble CPAP looks. So it is going from the air and oxygen, humidifier, inspirator limb, going to the patient by different interface, expirator limb going into the water. Now I'm not going to, there are some people have asked how pressure is generated by the bubble chamber. That's a different lecture. I would ask you to look at the video which I have in the YouTube. But this whatever is the depth of immersion from the water level down, that is the pressure which you are giving to the patient. So these are the different interfaces. You can see this is Hudson prong. This is a mask. This is a dragger mask. Again, dragger mask, inspirator limb, expirator limb connected to a dragger mask. You have appropriate
I think video is not there, sir, in one screen.
No. No, now no video. Now we are showing only the PowerPoint. Okay, sorry. Now it's okay. The PowerPoint visible?
Yes, sir. Fine.
Okay. So this is what I'm saying. You can use a Hudson prong. You can use a Rams cannula, or you can use a mask. Now, as the experience improved, we are using Rams cannula for a baby more than 1 kg. Less than 1 kg, we are using the mask. And some babies, we use Hudson prongs also. All three are very good. Whatever you use, you continue to use it. But the simplest and the easiest one is Rams cannula. But Rams cannula difficulty is, it is should be used only for more than 1 kg babies. Less than 1 kg baby, it may not be sufficient. So this is what I was saying about Hudson prongs. You have different cap sizes. You have different prong sizes. And these prong sizes are based on the weight of the baby for Hudson prongs. Fish and Paykel also has different prong sizes. And there are other interfaces like IFD prongs, RGL prongs. So now comes to the settings. Now we have already started. We have started with a flow of 5 liters with a CPAP pressure of 5 centimeters, FiO to 30%. We said humidification, there is no range. 37 degrees Celsius, 100% relative humidity. So that is fixed because you have humidifiers which comes fixed. They are servo humidifiers. So you have option of only 3. In this, we are fixing the flow also 5 liters. So leftover is only CPAP and FiO2. Now, how do we increase FiO2 or how do we increase pressure? How do we decrease pressure and how do we decrease FiO2? So to make a change in FiO2 and pressure, we should look at the saturations. If your saturation is less than 90%, you have started already, but if your saturation is less than 90%, look at the retractions. If retractions are there, you increase your pressure from 5 to 6. Continue to increase till your retractions are coming down. Now, if retractions are stable, not increasing, they are coming down. If you have desaturation less than 90%, increase your FiO2. So simple, saturation low, retractions, increase pressure. Not much retractions, increase FiO2. So we know how to increase. Now, how do we decrease? Again, very simple now. If there are no retractions, decrease the FiO2. If it is on 60%, you come down every 5% till your FiO2 comes to less than 30%. Once your FiO2 is less than 30%, then you decrease your pressure from 7 to 6, 6 to 5, 5 to 4. Once you are in a pressure of 4, FiO2 less than 30, preferably less than 25%, the baby is out of CPAP. So increasing, look at retractions. Decreasing, you can decrease only when there are no retractions and your saturations are above 95%. Saturation above 95%, retractions are not there. You need to come down on FiO2 and pressure. When you're coming down, first come down on the FiO2 to less than 30% and then come down on pressure from 7 to 6 to 5 and then to 4. Once you are in 4, FiO2 less than 30%, then you can know that this baby may not require CPAP. In small babies, less than 1 kg, the moment you remove CPAP, the baby will have apnea. So those babies on minimal settings of 4 pressure and FiO2 maybe 21 to 25%, you continue them on CPAP till apneas become passive. Bigger babies, like more than 1 kg, no apneas. These babies, when you shift from CPAP, you can shift either to nasal cannula oxygen or to HFNC. And I'm sure Akash would have told you how to start HFNC. HFNC is very simple. Same flow of 5 liters, you remove the expirator limb. To the inspirator limb, you connect the HFNC prongs. HFNC prongs, inspirator limb, keep the same flow, same FiO2. So from CPAP, you have come to HFNC. So that is what is this. So start with a pressure of 5. And how do we change the FiO2 is based on your chest retractions, FiO2, and air entry. Now, if your pressure is reaching the lung or not, how do you know? Two ways to know your pressure is there, is they going to the lungs or not. If the pressure is going to the circuit, you will see bubbles in the bubble chamber. If pressure is going to the lung, you will hear the bubble sounds in the chest. So if bubble sounds are there in the chest and bubbles are there in the bubble chamber, that means your pressure is reaching the lung. And you will start seeing a decrease in retractions. And on the X-ray, you will see the intercostal spaces should be 6 to 8. More than 8, your pressure is high. Less than 6, your pressure is low. flow 5 liters. 5 liters is sufficient for generating pressure from 4 to 8. Suppose you are requiring high flow, but you started with 5 flow, there are no leaks in the circuit, but still there is no bubbling. So what should you do? If there is no bubbling, first you have to go back and see any leaks are there in the circuit. If there are no leaks in the circuit, increase the flow to 6 liters. Still bubbles are not there, increase the flow to 7 liters. Still no bubbles, that means your circuit there, definitely there is a leak in the circuit. If you are not getting bubbles with 7 liters flow, there is something wrong in the circuit. You should get bubbles with 7 liters flow for all the babies. Start with 5. Most of the time 5 is sufficient, but bubbles should be there. If no bubbles, look for leaks. If no leaks, increase the pressure of flow from 5 to 6, 6 to 7. FiO2 should be 30%. It should be able to maintain saturation between 91 to 95. If you have a blood gas, the PaO2 should be between 50 to 70. So how do we maintain? Always when the baby is on CPAP, your FiO2 should be, saturation should be between 90 to 95%. Your FiO2 can be between 21 to 60%. Even on 60% FiO2, baby continues to have retractions, saturation is less than, say saturation is less than 90, you have already increased the pressure from 5 to 6, 6 to 7. 7 pressure and FiO2 60%, retractions are still there. First look at whether there are leaks, no leaks. There are no leaks, you are able to hear the bubble sounds in the chest, that means you are giving good CPAP. Still retractions are there, still saturations are less than 90%, that means the baby needs ventilation, either nasal IMV or ventilation. CPAP pressure should be between 4 to 7, some people use up to 8. So increasing pressure is based on only retractions or X-ray. As I already told you, if retractions are there, you increase the pressure. If X-ray is showing low volume, increase the pressure. Flow, in ventilator, it can be 6 to 8 liters. I've already said flow is 5 liters fixed, but no bubbling in the bubble chamber, increase to 6. Still no bubbles, increase to 7. No bubbles, there is definitely leak in the circuit. Less than 4 pressure is never given. 4 to 7, most of the time, it is the best pressures which you can give. More than 7, please do not use for babies on CPAP. If you don't have a blender, we have seen a blender, air, oxygen and blender. This you can use if you have a Y connection. Air, oxygen, a Y connection is there. How much air you mix with how much oxygen, you get how much FiO2, you can use this chart. Suppose I'm mixing 2 liters of oxygen and total flow, suppose I'm giving 4. I'm giving total flow 4 liters, out of which I'm saying 2 liters of oxygen and 2 liters is air. So how much FiO2 I get? Around 60%. This is 50%, this is about 60%. 4 liters, 50% if I want to give, I want to give about 1.7 liters of oxygen and 2.3 liters of air. So this is a simpler chart if you don't have blender, but I would suggest you should have a blender. We have already said that humidification is very important. There are no ranges. Your humidifier should give 37, 100% relative humidity. To ensure that you are giving correct humidity, there should be no condensation in your blue tube. Where there is heater wire, there should not be any condensation. In the expiratory limb, there should be small mist. Then you know you are correct giving humidification correctly. Your humidifier should show 37, no condensation in inspiratory limb, some mist in the expiratory limb means you are giving the correct humidification for the baby. So we said how to know flow, how you are increasing or decreasing, pressure, how you are decreasing, increasing, FiO2, how you are increasing and decreasing. What else you have to do for a baby on CPAP? You look at the baby and the airway, you look at the prong and each shift, circuit to look for condensation and leaks, machine you have to see, continuously monitor how much is FiO2, whether bubbles are there in the bubble chambers or not, and always look for complications. So what do we monitor in the baby? Temperature, CFT, heart rate and blood pressure. If your CFT is getting prolonged, immediately look whether you are giving high pressure. That means chest is hyperinflated, no retractions. CFT is getting prolonged. Your pressure is high. Decrease the pressure. And if the retractions are there, look for bubbles in the bubble chamber and look for bubble here for the bubbles in the chest. Then if bubbles are heard in the chest and bubbling is there in the bubble chamber, That means your CPAP is working. If still retractions are there, increase the pressure. So for increasing pressure, you have to look for chest expansion. You should look for retractions and air entry. And urine output, abdominal distension, and bowel sound should be seen to see whether there is any complication which is happening. If there is IVH, early IVH, baby will become dull and poor and pale. So tone, activity responsiveness should be measured or should be monitored. We should continuously monitor how much FiO2 giving, how much CPAP is going to the patient, how much flow is going to the patient. And if you have facility blood gas and X-ray, no need to do repeated X-ray. One X-ray after starting the baby on CPAP to see how much is the air inflation. And second is to know the diagnosis. Suppose you started the baby on CPAP. You get an X-ray. X-ray showing RDS, low volume lung, reticular granularity, and baby is already on CPAP. You give surfactant by insure and continue the baby on CPAP. I said baby on CPAP, X-ray showing RDS, you give surfactant and give continue the baby on CPAP. So Silverman score, I said, you should know it. I will show you the chart in the end. And other thing you have to monitor is you should have a chart like this. Time, heart rate, respirator. Every 1 hour, the nurse need to monitor heart rate, respiratory rate, retraction, CFT, CPAP, SpO2, FiO2. And if you have blood gas should be written here. Urine output and gas, abdominal girth. So we said what we need to monitor in the baby. Now in the airway, that is the nose of the baby. Suction the nose frequently, mouth frequently. Every 3 to 4 hours, you have to suction the nose and mouth. And you have to put nasal drops into the nose so that there is no block. And moisten the nails with saline or sterile water. Pass a suction catheter more at least in each shift to ensure. So into the nose, you pass a small saline catheter each shift so that there is no block in the nose. Now, how do we know that your CPAP is working well? Now, to know CPAP is working well, you should know your FiO2 is appropriate, your pressure is adequate, and your flow is adequate, and humidification is appropriate. How do you know your FiO2 is adequate? That means your saturations are between 90 to 95%. How do you know your pressure is adequate? If your pressure is adequate, there will be minimal or no retractions. There is no hyperinflation on the chest from when you look at the baby from side. There is no hyperinflation and minimal retractions or no retraction. That means your pressure is adequate. Baby is comfortable, minimal no retractions. Air entry should be there. Bubble should be heard in the bubble in the chest and bubble should be seen in the bubble chamber. That means your pressure is all right. Then flow. Flow means your bubbles in the bubble chamber are seen. If no bubbles in the bubble chamber, your flow is inadequate or leak in the circuit. So to say adequacy, comfortable baby, minimal no retraction, no grunt. Capillary refill time should be normal. If it is increased, your pressure could be high or there is hypovolemia. Saturation should be between 90 to 95%. To do a blood gas, it should be normal range. Most important is bubbling should be seen and bubble sound should be heard. Now, how do we decrease? I've already told you, if your baby is on a pressure of 7, FiO2 60%. Baby has good inflation, comfortable baby, saturations are above 95%. No retraction, saturation above 95%. Baby is already on pressure of 7, FiO2 60%. So you decrease FiO2 to 55%. Saturations are normal, no retractions, and baby is maintaining good saturation. Bubbles are heard and bubbles are seen. Decrease to 50. Decrease to 45, decrease to 40. At a point, if you see that saturation is falling down, you keep the FiO2 at that level. And if the retractions are and continue to come down the FiO2 till it is less than 30%. Once the baby is on FiO2 less than 30%, decrease the pressure from 7 to 6, 6 to 5, and 5 to 4. 4 pressure, FiO2 less than 30, baby is ready to be taken off from CPAP. So decrease pressure to 4. Gradually after decreasing FiO2 and the disease process should have improved. If CPAP 4 and FiO2 25%, clinically well, shift the baby on HFNC. If the baby is, baby is more than 1 kg, shift to HFNC. Baby less than 1 kg, continue baby on CPAP till there are no apneas. So once you want to shift the baby on HFNC, this is how. The inspiratory limb is connected to a different prong called HFNC prong, where the prongs occupy less than 50% of the nose. There should be good leak in HFNC prong. In CPAP prong, the nose should be snugly fitting. So after removing from CPAP, do oronasal suction, watch for apneas, increasing tachypnea, increasing retractions. If retractions come, tachypnea starts off, you should put the baby back on CPAP. And you should keep changing the positions of the baby. when do you say CPAP is not work, you have to go for ventilation. If baby continues to have retractions and grunt, recurrent apneas on and not maintaining saturation less than 90% on a pressure of 7 or more, FiO2 more than 60%. You have already increased the pressure, you have already increased the FiO2. Still baby is having apneas, retractions, grunt. That means you have to go for the ventilation. So sometimes baby is fighting continuously. Nothing is working. So most of the time, why do babies fight CPAP? Most important reason is humidification. There is a lot of water in the circuit. Your humidifier is not working, babies will fight. A lot of secretion, babies will fight. Your nose is hurting, the prongs are causing injury, baby will fight. Baby has abdominal distension, baby will fight. Is not passed urine and stool, baby will fight. So most of the babies fight because your CPAP is not applied well. If you apply the CPAP well, babies comfortably sleep and the distress will automatically come down. So reasons for failure are CPAP system more than the baby. Or it could be worsening of distress, but mostly failure of system. But sometimes it can be increasing distress or shock or neurological problem where you have to ventilate the baby. So prior to intubation, do not treat the blood gas. Look at the baby. Really, baby failed or your saturations are low because the probe is out. So look for probe and other things before you say baby has failed CPAP. And always look for if condensation problem is there, whether water is there in the bubble chamber or not, continuous bubbling is there or not, whether leaks are there or your mouth is, baby continues to cry. These conditions can also cause failure. Before you say intubate, you have to ensure these are not there. So there is, and airways also have to be taken care. You can have a small checklist like that before you say baby has failed. So look at the prongs, look at the interface, look at the circuit, look at the baby and see that your CPAP is done very well. So this is a simplified chart which I'll share with all of you. So it tells you what are the indications, what are the contraindications, how do you prepare the machine, how do you initiate CPAP. I said pressure of 5, FiO2 30%, flow of 5 liters for respiratory distress. But if baby has apnea, baby apnea means lungs are not problem. So you start with a pressure of 4, FiO2 less than 25%, flow of 5. For all the conditions, flow is 5. For no lung disease, pressure is 4 or 5, FiO2 is less than 25% apneas. Post extubation, pressure is 5 and FiO2 same as that on extubation. You extubate on 25%, on CPAP also give 25%. So once you start, you adjust the FiO2 and pressure based on the retractions and saturation and X-ray, and they continue to do the nursing care, that is baby care, interface care and the circuit care. And if baby is stable, wean off. Baby fails, you shift to nasal INV or to ventilation. This is the Silverman score I was talking about. So it has upper chest, lower chest, sternal retractions, nasal flaring and grunting. And these are the monitoring chart for baby, interface and circuit. And this is the troubleshoot. In the troubleshoot, you look at the bubbles, bubbling sound and the pressure and FiO2 which you are giving and any water in the circuit. Based on the problem, you can have a solution here. So to summarize, CPAP is for babies who are breathing normally or have a normal breathing effort and distress. CPAP pressure you titrate based on the retractions. Baby has retractions, you have to increase the pressure. No retractions, look at the saturation. Saturations are good, decrease FiO2 and then decrease the pressure. FiO2, you titrate based on the saturations. Flow is only to ensure that the flow is there continuously in the circuit. How will you know flow is causing pressure? By looking at the bubbles in the bubble chamber. If bubbles are there, your flow is adequate. So monitor the baby, interface and the circuit. Wean first the FiO2 and then the pressure. And failure is uncommon. If you have failure, first do the checklist before going for ventilation. So that's all. Thank you. So I'll take a lot of questions so it becomes easier for all of you.
Thank you, Srinivas. In the beginning, I said it was extra inning, but actually it was one day. ODI with full of 6s and 4. And frankly speaking, in 30 years of my pediatric practice, it is one of the best lecture in neonatology. It was amazing.
Thank you.
So before Dheeraj and other anchors start asking questions, few basic questions from myself. After how much time one should think for increment or decrease? If retraction are there and pressure is on 5, for how much time one should wait?
So very good question, sir. So that is why we said you have to